Thank you so much. Hi, everyone, and thanks for joining me. Hopefully, some of you have been in my webinars before, and if so, thank you for joining me again. Tonight's topic is handling emergencies, and it's obviously just very relevant right now. So much of the country and Puerto Rico undergoing all kinds of natural disasters, from hurricanes and earthquakes to wildfires. There's just a lot going on, and so this is an important topic. And also, October is Emergency Preparedness Month with Child Care Aware. So we wanted to highlight this important topic and help you with some resources that can help you stay prepared and also offer comfort to kids just in case something does happen. So it's important to be prepared for emergencies or disasters like these, and it's also important to offer that comfort and consolation afterwards, especially to our littlest community members who often don't understand fully what's happened. So today we will define emergencies pretty broadly. Then we're gonna walk through some childcare specific considerations. And then we're gonna explore a few resources to help you prepare for emergencies, and then we're going to also offer some strategies and really the Sesame approach for helping kids feel safe and secure after an emergency or during any difficult situation or uncertain time. So let's get started with what is an emergency. And there are obviously many definitions and nuances to the definition, but here at Sesame Street, we think of an emergency as something that happens that we do not expect, and we have to act quickly in order to stay safe. And there's a video on Sesame Street and Communities where Grover really explains what that is in a kid-friendly way. And I don't know if you all know Andy Rozak from Child Care Aware, but we just wrapped up recording a webinar with him that will be live on October 18th, I believe. So you can check out what he has to say. But one thing that he told us about emergencies is that it's important to note that an emergency can be different for different people. He basically defined it as an emergency is a situation that overwhelms our capacity to deal with it or remedy it. So that can be big or small. So for instance, a child could trip and fall and scrape their knee so that it's bleeding a lot, or maybe they twist an ankle. Well, for one person, you know, they might be able to handle that situation. Maybe they're not queasy about blood, or maybe they have a medical background and they can sort of help with that situation. While for others, that might be an emergency because they have to ask for outside help. So it's just important to remember that emergencies really do vary based on your capabilities to deal with them and cope at that certain time and with that situation. But let's go through just a few examples of emergencies, and you're probably familiar with most of these. These are injuries, like I said, natural disasters or weather events like tornadoes, fires, and floods. You know, we've seen all these hurricanes and unfortunately the earthquake down in Mexico. There's just so many things that can happen that are really out of our control. But there are other things like medical emergencies. So that could be a child in your program has a medical emergency, or it could be you, the caregiver, who has a medical emergency. And as we'll talk about, having a preparedness plan that's really comprehensive. And making sure that, you know, you're really prepared and have plans for if a child gets hurt or if you get hurt and you need backup care or something like that. Another important one or two here are these obstructed roadways or some sort of parental separation. And what I mean by that is, you know, especially in a weather event, objects can fall in the road, or maybe there's an earthquake and some roads are damaged or not safe to pass, and that can hinder parents from getting to your child care center. Other situations, you know, parents might have a situation at work or something that happens during the day where they're not able to get to you and you have to keep the child for a longer amount of time. Those are other types of emergencies that you can consider when you're planning and being prepared for these difficult situations. So for instance, parents could choose or map out a couple of different ways to get to your program, or, you know, conversely, you can try to get to them if you know a different route, or you just need to have a plan for keeping kids a little bit longer so that, you know, they're really safe and sound and secure in your care. So hopefully you have not experienced a very serious emergency in your childcare setting, but it's likely that you've encountered some sort of difficult situation. The important thing to remember is that we can get ready for emergencies, big and small, together. And in just a little bit, I'm going to walk you through some resources that we've created on Sesame Street that can help you engage kids and their families in your program's emergency preparedness planning. So, but first, let's take a moment to talk about some things that childcare providers specifically should consider when thinking about emergency preparedness. I just want to really emphasize how important your childcare centers are and you are as providers for kids, and you're really doing such an immense service, and I know that you know that about yourselves. But you're really, really important to communities, and you're especially important to helping communities get back and recuperate after a disaster. So childcare, or lack of childcare after a disaster, is one of the biggest setbacks to getting communities back up and running after a disaster. So that's why we're talking about this today, is because you're so vital to the communities, and we want you to be able to be prepared for all kinds of things that could impact your childcare program. It doesn't even have to be a weather event. You know, it could just be some loss in your family or some financial situation. We really want you to be prepared to manage those things, because you are vital and helpful, so helpful in the recuperation of your community after an event. So in this next slide, these are some things that I drew from Childcare Aware, and you're maybe familiar with Tom Copeland. So they worked together to create some resources that are really great that you might want to check out if you haven't already, at childcareaware.org, and I'll be sure to share the link afterwards. But here are some tips for childcare providers that they give that we really need to keep in mind. So the first one is, have the correct insurance coverage. And I know this is not a glamorous subject, but it's really important. And we hear these stories all the time that, you know, you think you have a certain coverage and maybe a flood happens and there's some stipulation that you maybe weren't clear on, and you actually aren't covered for the things that you thought you were. It's just really important to be clear on what your coverage is and that you have the correct coverage. So they have a PDF called, the second one is have, but we need to consider building up an emergency fund specifically for our childcare programs. So making sure that you have some money, some assets to leverage, just in case, you know, some property is damaged or something like that, that you can replace materials that you really need for your programs to go on. The third is, conduct a household inventory. And I know I'm a renter, and I know for renter's insurance, we have to have an inventory, and it's just a good idea to know what you have in your home. But I wanted to extend an idea, because we actually have an activity on Sesame Street and communities that's, I think it's called a vocabulary walk or something like this. And I might have talked about this idea before, but this task, I know your time is precious, and so making sure you have all of these things in place can feel a little daunting, especially if you have to do these things on your own time when you're not caring for kids. So this is an activity that the kids can help you with, and you can really turn into a learning lesson in your program. And so one way I thought of doing that is that you could make it a language lesson. You know, you could go around a room, maybe the classroom part of your home, or their cubbies or something like that. And you could have each child write down the items that they, or maybe just talk about if they're littles, have them talk about the items that they use on a daily basis, or maybe the things that they keep specifically for them in their cubbies. You can walk and talk around the room. So as you're taking inventory, maybe writing things down on a tablet or on a clipboard, you can be talking with kids and really expanding their vocabulary about what objects are in the room, and then ask fun questions about how they experience those things or what those things are used for. And of course, kids have the best stories and the best explanations for things. So I think that would just be a really good way to incorporate kids and also get something checked off your personal list. Okay, so the next thing is that they recommend that you keep your records in a safe place. And I've heard many of you have Go boxes or Go books with important contact information and details about kids and their families and your policies and things like that, just ready to grab and go, which is great. I think that's a great start. But one thing you might want to consider is also having a digital backup or a couple of backups, maybe something in a cloud service, so that you have your items, your important items, in a couple of different places, so that just in case, maybe a fire happens and you're not able to grab that Go box or that Go bag, and you don't have that information anywhere else. We just really recommend that you have duplicates and just have those in different places, but you don't want it all digital, because if cell phone service is down or internet's not working and you have the hard copy, that's always a blessing too. And then this next one is leverage your network. So I love this one because it's really, I think you all are so good at building community and just making your communities better through your childcare. And so this one is all about leveraging your network, getting to know the people in your area. So we'll talk a little bit later about helpers, your community helpers, but this is also, are there other childcare providers in your neighborhood or close by? Are there parents in your program who can lend a hand or have a flexible schedule? Or have talents that you can tap into if things need to be rebuilt or if a fundraiser needs to happen for lost goods or something like that. So just tapping into your network, having someone on hand that can fill in for you if you're sick or if something happens in your family that you need to attend to. Just having that network of people to help you, to be a backup, and to really leverage. And then finally, this last one I'm sure you guys are familiar with is have clear parent and staff policies. So especially when we're talking about emergency plans, it's really good to have them in writing. It's good to share them with parents and any staff if you have staff. But it's also really important to articulate verbally, practice with parents, practice with staff, make sure that everybody is really familiar sort of in their bodies with the protocols and the emergency plans that you have in place. So if you have, evacuation plan and you need to meet up somewhere, make sure parents really know where that place is or know what to do or know alternate numbers to call. Just really be clear that everybody knows, and it's not just in writing, but it's a discussion that you have that really sets parents and you and the kids all at ease. This is just a reiteration. This is the webinar that we recorded with Andy. He's kind of a fascinating guy. He has an interesting background when it comes to emergencies and emergency preparedness. So you can hear some of his experience there. And so if you want to check that out, it's at 1 p.m. on the 18th, or you can watch it anytime on demand after that time. So I've been talking a lot, and I just want to ask you all, what, if any, do you have, I want to know what your best practices are. What's something in your program that you're really proud of when it comes to emergency preparation? Okay, so Elizabeth says she has a place to go and parents all trust it. That's great. Jamie has a backup close by, which is really, really good. Emergency kits, people have emergency kits, which is great. We'll talk a little bit about those later. Great. Yeah, we have a go bag hanging right beside the door to be grabbed easily if we want to evacuate. Great. So you guys all have emergency kits, which is really good. Oh, this is good. So Lisa is, she has lots of smoke detectors, and they only live 3 blocks away from the fire department. I'm also going to talk a little bit about community helpers in a minute, so that's great. Great. Oh, I like this. So we have in-home, in-town, and out-of-town plans in place. I think that's really, really good to just be prepared for a variety of different situations. I love that you're thinking ahead. Ashley does tornado and fire practice. So I grew up in Oklahoma, so I'm familiar with those tornado drills, and I remember practicing them, and it really does come in handy when you know, a real thing is close by to really be sure of what we're doing. So these are great answers, and I appreciate you participating. Let's move on to getting ready. So we already have heard some great examples of what people have thought about, and what I want to encourage you to think about even more is how you get kids and families involved in being emergency ready. So we can do this together. So let's see. So here at Sesame, we have identified 5 ways that kids, families, and providers can get ready for emergencies together. And you'll see these 5 things reiterated in multiple ways on our website. They're very important, and so we like to emphasize them. But here are the things. So we need to learn whole names. So kids should know their whole names, their parents' whole names, and your whole names. So especially, you know, theirs and their parents, but they spend a lot of time with you as well. And I think it's important that they know your name as well. The second thing is that they need to practice their addresses and phone numbers. And I want to just give a little compliment to my mom, because I think she did a really great job with this when I was a kid. I still remember my first phone number because she made it into a fun little game, sort of. It had 2 twos together, and she always said, "It's like a choo-choo train," and we'd pump our fists like we were blowing the whistle on a choo-choo train, and so we'd say 8221. And I think, you know, things like that, little songs, really help kids remember those addresses and phone numbers, which are lots of letters, lots of words, and lots of numbers. So any way we can make it fun is a great idea. Then this next thing is that we want to point out our special helpers. So one of you mentioned that you're, you know, very close to a fire station. Our special helpers, our community helpers, are really those people like firefighters, police officers, school nurses, school staff, anyone from a hospital or an EMT would be a special helper. But it's also good to note that many communities have sort of safe haven spots where maybe it's identified by a sticker on the outside of the business. I know in my hometown, some gas stations were safe havens. So if kids were, you know, alone for some reason or in a tough situation and they needed help, they could look for that sticker and go to that place and they were sure to find help and guidance. So that's also a thing to look into in your neighborhood. And then there's also means knowing your neighbors. And I know we live in kind of a different world today. You know, not everybody knows their neighbors. It's not healthcare providers. You all have rules and specifications about what you need to be prepared for in your program. So please follow those rules. And I'm not an expert on those things. You can talk with an AFCC or childcare aware programs like that to really make sure you're matching all that you need to do. But what I want to emphasize is that it's really important to keep kids involved and to help them understand why they'd use the kit or that they may never need it, that it's just there just in case. And then I want you to practice your emergency plans often enough that kids are really familiar with what to do. So monthly might be good, weekly might be good. I know some people practice a few things daily, which I think is good too. It's really just how much you think your kids need to be really comfortable and not scared of the situation. And I think it's always important to remember that kids learn best through repetition, through routine. And even if they, you know, even if you think a drill every day is a little bit too much, just you can practice, you know, listening and taking instructions and following the leader. Those types of things will help in most emergency situations. And those things can be practiced daily. And parents will appreciate that too, I'm sure. So let's take a minute to watch a fun little video about learning whole names. Hopefully this will open up and play for us here. Take it a minute. Here we go.
Hola, Grover!
What are you doing?
Well, I'm getting ready for an emergency.
Looks like you're playing the guitar to me.
I am. I'm practicing a special song about my first and last names. It's really, really important to know them in an emergency.
Oh, I know. Because sometimes you are not with your mommy or daddy, or even babysitter. If you know your whole name, people can help your family find you.
See, Grover!
But how does your song help you remember your first and last name?
Like this! Oh, my first name's Rosita. I'll sing it loud. Oh, my last name, De Las Cuevas.
De Las Cuevas?
See, sí, and it makes me proud. I'm Rosita de las Cuevas. Now I bet that's a name you'll never forget. Now it's your turn. Oh, your first name's
Alexa, Romeo, Amanda.
You'll the notes will help you remember your parents' names.
Huh, I already know my mommy's name.
Oh!
It is Mommy.
That's what I call my mommy too. But mommies and daddies also have first and last names.
Really?
Really, listen. My mommy's first name is Rosa.
Rosa.
Good. I'll sing it loud.
Sing it loud.
Oh, oh, her last name's De Las Cuevas.
Oh, oh, oh.
And it makes me proud.
It makes her proud. She's Rosa De Las Cuevas. Now we've heard. That's a name you'll never forget. And now it's your turn again. Your parents' first name is
Carolyn,
Stacy,
Barbara, Norman.
Singing it loud.
Singing it loud. Your parents' last name is
Jameson,
Colin,
Murphy,
Rosa,
Vivette.
And it makes you proud.
It makes you proud.
Jackie Wilbur, John Wilbur.
Now Vivette, that's a name you'll never forget. First last name
you'll never forget.
First last name.
What are the whole names of the grown-ups that take care of you?
So that's pretty cute. Grover like always makes me laugh. You have, your mom has a first and last name. I think it's something that parents kind of take for granted a few times. You know, sometimes that kids just know their name, but they really know them as mom and dad. So it's important to know those whole names. And it's also important to know addresses and phone numbers. And the other asset you'll see on the screen is just a printable. They can draw a picture of their home, ask a grown-up to write down the address. They can practice pushing the numbers on the page of their address. Their phone number. And so they can really practice dialing their number or dialing your number, dialing 911 if you want to go through that protocol. And this is something that obviously you can hand to parents as well. So you can have one in your program, you can have one in their parents' program or parents' home. And so everybody can have that sort of information and be practicing both at home and in your setting. Okay, this next one is all about knowing your helpers. And this is another great way to get kids involved and help them get to know their community. So this is a printable and it's a maze. You can color the buildings in and then take the kids through them. And as they go through the maze, you can talk about the different helpers in the neighborhood that we're seeing here. I thought it would be really fun because I know every neighborhood is unique and, you know, I don't know where you all are coming from, but I suspect all across the country. And so I thought this would be a fun activity to really personalize and customize to your neighborhood or your community. And I was imagining, I know some of you have felt boards on the wall or a bulletin board. You could really make a large size of a map of your community and paste pictures of the actual helpers that are in your neighborhood or the neighbors around you, and have kids really get familiar with the actual places in your neighborhood and the helpers there. Another idea, which this was so much fun when I was a kid, going to the fire station and getting a tour. Going in the truck and turning the lights on. Maybe that's just a small town thing, but I remember very vividly doing that. And I remember also that it made me less afraid of the idea of asking a firefighter for help if I needed one, or going to a fire station if I had an emergency that would ever come up. So having tours of maybe a hospital would also be an interesting learning experience. Schools obviously is a great place to go and walk through and meet a principal, meet a school nurse, meet a guidance counselor, and actually really get them ready for school as well. So think about the helpers that you have in your community and just go from there. I want to ask just real quickly if any of you do something like this, if you have something where, you know, you can make your community come to life for your kiddos. Oh my goodness. So Elizabeth says here that she gets the trucks and police cruisers to come to her house with lights and sirens and then all the things to help kids not be scared. I think that's really fun. I mean, you can turn those things into learning lessons of all kinds. So, you know, they can help, they can learn about helpers, they can learn about why the lights are there, why the sirens are going off, how that keeps them safe. Terry also lives in a rural community, and she says she's gone to her township fire hall, which is great. It really was a very fun memory for me. Great. And so Linda's son is a police officer, and he comes to visit with his cruiser and answer some questions for the kids. Okay, lots of visits. I'm glad you guys are visiting your neighborhood. And I love this one. So Lisa has two parents who are police officers. I love that they know they're in their immediate community and that their peers have community helpers. That's really great. Awesome. So the last two that we mentioned were creating an emergency preparation plan and also the emergency kits. I don't think I need to talk about the kits very much. I think you all sort of have that. But one thing I want to point out is just this article called Emergency Preparation for Childcare Providers. And I think the Childcare Aware resources are really great and very thorough. But this is more of a starting baseline of things that you can think about that might impact or threaten your program. And this will help you start thinking about what you can, how you can explain those things to kids, how you can explain those things and work with families, and then what you can prepare for yourself in your own setting. So be sure to take a look at that and just get your mind going and try to think, you know, from different perspectives. So, you know, we kind of think about tornadoes and fires and things that, you know, might be common to our region, but think about things that are a little outside the box or not necessarily what we would think of as an emergency, but something that would impact the way we run our business or our ability to run our business. That's really what the things that we want to think about when we're making emergency preparation plans. And then the printables on the right are Let's Make and Share Our Plan. And these are great for families to have a copy so that they can give to even, you know, babysitters or grandparents or people from out of town that might be caring for their kids. And it's also great for you to have on hand to just get to know how you can reach parents, what alternative contact information they have. And photos is a really nice touch here too. So sometimes I know kids in a disastrous situation, they might forget their whole name or their parents' name. And so, you know, having a photo of the family can be really helpful in reuniting that family if they were to be separated for any reason. So we've gone through just a handful of emergency preparation resources, and I just want to get your feedback on how you'd use any of these resources that I've shared with you. Any ideas? Yep. So keep them all informed of your emergency plans. That's really key. You know, just talking through the written plans. I know you probably all have written plans in your policies, but really talking them through, hosting a parent workshop if you can. Really getting families together and kids together so that everybody's really well rehearsed, practiced enough as they need to be, and and sharing all the same information, so we're really on the same page. Great. So the next part of this presentation is really about supporting kids' social and emotional wellness, either after an emergency or really in any difficult situation or uncertain time. So the strategies I'm about to go through, you can really apply them not only to emergencies, but if the child is going through any sort of difficult time, you can use this approach. So when Sesame Street, when we're creating content specifically for difficult times, and what I mean by difficult times is if you go on Sesame Street and communities, we sort of have the content blocked out in three buckets. So we've got difficult times and tough talks. We've got wellness, you know, emotional and physical wellness. And then we've got ABCs and 1-2-3s. And so this difficult times bucket really covers anything from the divorce of parents, the incarceration of a loved one, maybe food insecurity, also emergency preparedness and response, just sort of these tough topics and bigger issues that kids might not know how to articulate how they're feeling about them. They might not understand them. And parents might not know how to talk to them. Grown-ups or caregivers might not know how to talk to parents about these things. So this is kind of what I'm talking about here. And when we're thinking about these difficult times, we aim to do these four things. So we always want to represent the child's perspective. And what we often find is that the small voice of the child is lost in the chaos of a difficult situation. So whether that's a divorce or an emergency, you know, when grown-ups go through these difficult things, it can be really hard to remember that children are experiencing these things so differently. So it's really important to remember for caring grown-ups to contextualize what these events are, why they happened, what actually happened. You know, sometimes kids can really conflate a situation. Maybe there's a car accident and they think, you know, a monster hit us, but really it was a car accident. A car hit them. And it really is important for grown-ups in these situations who obviously know what happened right away to help kids understand and contextualize this big scary thing that happened in and give them time to really cope with that. The second thing we do is identify simple moments or strategies that can make a big difference. So especially in uncertain times, after a big event, you know, we can be tempted as grown-ups to fix everything all at once or make big changes to make things better. But we know that it works better to make small, consistent steps to help. So we try to ask, what is the simplest change that we can make to help families? Sorry, what is the simplest change we can help families make that will get them toward a larger goal of healing or communication or basic routines? So if we ask that of ourselves when we create content, and we want providers like you to do the same. So if you're noticing that a child is having a problem coming to terms with something, you know, just take one small step and repeat it daily. Repeat it often, you know, give them an affirmation. Have their parents, you know, really stick to one small routine, because that continuity and that consistency can really make a big difference in the well-being, social emotional well-being of that child. The third thing here is that we, of course, want to be sure that parents and providers like yourself take care of yourselves during these hard times. You know, traumatic experiences, big changes in life, and certainly, you know, the devastation of a natural disaster can be really hard on kids and grown-ups. And so it's just really important to take care of yourself and take the time you need and articulate that need to the parents and the networks we talked about before to make sure you're asking for help when you need it. And then this final one, it kind of taps into that as well. We have to recognize, and this is with everything, when interacting with parents, especially from our programs, that we have to recognize that big feelings happen from all sides. So, you know, the kids are going through a lot of big feelings, but in these difficult times, parents are dealing with their own big feelings. And it's just really important. It can be hard to navigate. It can be hard to have enough patience, but we do need to be aware that difficult times mean big feelings from everybody. So I want to watch just a short clip of a whole episode that we did on Sesame Street a couple years back. And it's called A Hurricane Comes to Sesame Street. And I just thought this was really pertinent to the things that are happening in our country right now. And so many people are rebuilding and you know, hoping that loved ones are safe and sound in Puerto Rico and other islands. So I just wanted to play this because this is a clip. A hurricane comes through Sesame Street, and Big Bird, his nest is destroyed, and he's very shaken up about it, and he's kind of frozen. And in the first few scenes, which you won't see, he keeps repeating, "My nest, my home." And so he, of course, his community on Sesame Street supports him by giving him a place to stay and taking the time to help him put his nest back together, but it's just going to take a little while. And so what I think this clip does is really articulate the child's perspective, which is Big Bird's perspective. He's kind of at a loss. He doesn't know what to do. He thinks things should be back to normal very quickly. He doesn't really understand the concept of time. But then what I also want you to notice is what Gordon and his wife Susan do to help. So the simple steps that they take to offer comfort and security. So let's just watch this clip.
So Alan gave me a birdseed snack, and then baby bear Elmo and Alan sang me a lullaby, and I took my nap right in Hoover's store.
Oh, well, I'm glad you got to take your nap, Big Bird.
Yeah, it was nice. Oh, yeah.
What? Big Bird, where are you going?
Oh, I'm going to go take a look out the kitchen window, see how my nest is doing.
Boy, that sounded like a sad sigh, Big Bird.
Yeah, well, I do feel sad, Susan. I looked at my nest and it's my home, you know, still not ready.
Yeah, we know, Big Bird, but you know, you always have a home with us.
Oh, yeah, nice, thank you.
You know, we're going to have dinner soon, but is there something you'd like to do before we eat?
Well, you know, Baby Bear drew a picture during the hurricane, and he said it made him feel better. So I think maybe I'd like to draw a picture.
Yeah.
But you know what? I don't have anything to draw with because the hurricane blew everything away.
Well, you know, Big Bird, we've got crayons and paper right here.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Here you go.
Oh, boy. This is great.
What are you going to draw, Big Bird?
Well, let's see. I think I'd like to draw a picture of my nest, my home, before the hurricane messed everything up.
Hey, now that's a good idea. All right. You know, we're going to go get dinner ready while you draw, okay?
Oh, yum, yum.
All right.
Okay.
Balance.
See ya. So, how's the picture coming, Big Bird?
Gordon, I just finished it.
Oh, great.
Yeah.
Can I see?
Sure. Ta-da. Hey. See?
Yeah.
It's a picture of my home before the hurricane. There's my nest, my mailbox, my alphabet sign, my toy chest. That's me and my nest with Radar.
Yeah.
Radar's very happy because he's home.
And you know, you look happy too, Big Bird.
Well, I'm happy in the picture, Gordon. Because that's the way things used to be.
And you know what, Big Bird? That's the way things are going to be too. As soon as we get everything fixed and cleaned up.
Oh, yeah. It's like two pictures. The way it used to be and the way it's going to be. You know something? What? I'm glad I drew this, Gordon.
You know, so am I.
Yeah.
All right. I really love this story, and I encourage you to watch the full episode. What I particularly love is how, you know, Gordon and Susan offer simple things to help him feel better, and they offer him space and time. And in the previous section of this story, Big Bird also wants to take a nap, and he doesn't have anywhere to take a nap because his nest is ruined. And so what they also do is offer him not only their home, but they offer him continuity in his everyday routines. So even though things aren't exactly the same, he still got to take a nap. He still got to eat a snack. And then he gets to color because they have some resources on hand for him. And they encourage him, right? So it's really these simple things. It's simple attention. It's letting him voice his fear, letting him voice his frustration that his nest isn't done yet, that it's not the way it used to be. But then they're able to shift that mentality and really give him a sense of hope. And so it's really important as a provider and as a caregiver who, you know, you see these kids all the time, you can notice a difference in their behavior if some big change is happening at home or if some weather event or emergency event does happen. You can notice the change in behavior and you can hone in on that and really be a secure point of contact and support for these kids. So I hope as you watch that, you were able to maybe think of a child in your program who needs a little extra care or you know, just ways that you can offer comfort to all of your kids that that can help them feel a little bit more comfortable and comforted, because you really don't know what's necessarily going on the whole time, you know, at home. So, you know, making sure that you offer comfort is good, even when there's not an emergency situation. And along with that video, there is a family guide that's really great that helps grown-ups answer big questions in appropriate ways for kids. And this resource is on Sesame Street and Communities, but it's also on this toolkit page. So you can go to sesamestreet.org/toolkit/emergencies. And the emergency preparation materials were on toolkit/ready. So you can feel free to visit there and have sort of all the resources in one, and they're repackaged, and there's some new content also on Sesame Street and Communities. And so our time together is closing now, but I wanted to present just one last resource that I think is really sweet. And I think this is a great way to, again, really encourage parents to also adopt these, you know, comfort-giving strategies and comfort-giving habits. So this is actually a workshop that you could do with parents in your program, or you could do it with other caregivers if you're a trainer. And I know I can't see you right now, but I did want to give this workshop a try. So if you're willing, I hope you're actually following along and at least humoring me here. But if you can, please grab a pen or pencil and a piece of paper. And you're going to need your hand also. And if you're ready, if you could just raise your little hand icon in the chat box so I can see. Okay, so people are playing along with me, which is great. Okay, so what you're gonna do is raise your actual hand, not just the little button on the screen. I want you to look at your hands, and I want you to think about all the things that you can do with your hands. all the ways that you help kids in your program. So you give them pats on the back, you give them hugs, you prepare snacks, you make crafts, right? You keep kids safe when they're crossing the street. You you make funny games with your hands. You can tell stories with your hands. Just take a moment to think about the things that you do. So next, I want you, if you were doing this with parents, I'd want you to remind them that you can use your hands to remember lots of different things. And right now, we're going to use our hands to help us remember things that we can do to help kids through troubling times. So what I want you to do is take your hand and place it on your paper and trace around your hand. You know, like you were making a Thanksgiving turkey or something. So you've got your hand traced. You can make it fancy if you want. And then on each of the fingers of your hand, we're going to write a word or two. So on the first finger, you're going to write helping hands. So helping hands really means remembering that we're not alone and that there are always helpers. So there's always someone that can help you, right? So we need to tell kids there's always someone that can help you. On the second finger, I want you to write hugs. We love hugs at Sesame Street. They help kids feel safe. They feel secure and comforted. Hugs can be reassuring. Hugs can be silly. A hug can really say a lot. So we've got helping hands, we've got hugs. The third one, is hearts. So this is really all about appreciating the power of kindness and compassion, showing empathy. So, you know, maybe kids are going through a hard time and you can say, I understand. I hear what you're going through. I know you have big feelings. Really allowing their feelings to be heard and listened to. So hearts help us appreciate the power of kindness. On the fourth finger, I want you to write hear, as in talking, listening, communicating. So these are, hearing is so important. Just taking the time to let kids tell their experience to you, right? Really listening. And then the last one is a different kind of hear. So this is being present, right? Keeping familiar routines, not being distracted by our cell phones or by other bad news or by our own feelings. You know, we have to be able to put aside our hard times to really connect with children and to let them know that we're here for them, we're listening to them, and we're here present with them. So at the end of this workshop, you would ask parents to describe a strategy of what each of these things might look like in a practical setting, practical application. So after we end this webinar, I encourage you to do that. So think about these five things: helping hands, hugs, hearts, hear, and here. Think about how you can apply these five things in practical ways in your setting and in your program, and how you can add little moments of comfort every day, whether there's an emergency or not. So let's just quickly review. We've covered quite a bit, and it's been really nice. I really love that helping hands activity. It helps me slow down and just remember, you know, what's really important in life. So anyway, let's review. So an emergency is something that happens that we do not expect, and we have to act quickly to stay safe. So the next thing is that we can have a comprehensive preparedness plan that gets kids and families involved in the process. And remember, that doesn't have to be a disaster. It doesn't have to be your ordinary, quote, ordinary emergency, but it can be anything that threatens your program from running smoothly, running consistently for families. So really think outside of the box. It's not just fires, it's not just tornadoes, it's, you know, financial distress, it's illness, or some family type emergency on your end as well. Remember that those things can impact your programs. But finally, your comfort and care can make a big difference after a difficult situation. Whether it's an emergency or something at home, you can make a really big difference every day. You already make a big difference every day, just being that kind, loving soul that you are for kids in your program. So as we wrap up, that's really all I wanted to share with you tonight. I'd love to know, what's your one takeaway from today's webinar? Great, Jamie. I'm glad to hear that the resources will be helpful. To you, Elizabeth. Good. Okay. Great. I'm glad you guys are liking the activity. I'm kind of not reading these, I guess, but lots of information about. Lots of you are saying that. The resources seem really helpful. So I'm glad to hear that. Yeah, and Anne, I'm glad. So she said, this gives me things to think about and ways to get organized. And I think that's really what the goal of this webinar is that, you know, there are lots of situations that could arise that you need to plan for. And it's hard to know them all at once. So just taking some time to be intentional about, you know, what are the threats to your program and how you can be a comforting figure to your kids anytime. Awesome. Okay, well, I would like to, you can contact us and keep in touch with us at communities@sesame.org. And we are on Facebook. And the last thing there, Sesame Street Community Providers, is a provider-only Facebook group that you can request access to. And coming up for October, we're releasing some really powerful content around traumatic experiences. And we go much more in depth into these coping strategies and comforting strategies. And we're going to be really active on our provider group coming up. So I encourage you to request access and start chatting with us there and learn even more about the resources we have to support your programs. And at this point, I'm ready to open it up to any questions you might have. So Lisa asked, do you have any information on foster children? And we don't have a lot right now, but I know it's one of the areas that we are exploring, and hopefully we'll be making a topic page for those families, hopefully in the next year, if not 2 years. But you should know that it's near and dear to many of us at Sesame Street, and we are looking into it. And if you want to email us any questions or requests or even great resources for advisors, you can email us at communities@sesame.org. For any new topic that we launch or dive into, we always gather an advisory board. So if you know someone that's doing really great work in the foster arena, we'd love to hear about them. Lorna, we appreciate you too. Thanks so much for sharing those kind words with me. It means a lot. All right, well, I think that we have covered, here we go. So Maria asked, can you do a webinar about helping autistic children cope? So our November webinar with NAFCC will be about our autism resources. So that'll be towards the end of November. So stay tuned for that one, and we will cover some of those things. Great. Okay. Thank you guys. It's been really great to talk with you and hear all your great ideas and the things that you're already doing for kids to help them stay safe and feel comforted. So I will talk to you guys very soon. I think Nicole, I can't hear you, but hopefully you can wrap us up.
Yep. Thanks, Tara. Thanks again for all of that. Just to remind everyone, your training hours will come by email tomorrow. If you have any other questions, you can get in contact with me at NAFCC, or if you have any questions that can go directly to Tara, her contact information is on the screen. So thanks guys, and good night.
Good night.